Batwoman chooses otherwise, but stylistically,
we based her a lot on the comics, so she was raised and trained by her father, Colonel King, so she has that military background, but we made sure that, you know, we didn't want her to be damsel in distress, because in the comics she was her own woman. It wasn't because Batman saved her that she became Batwoman, because she didn't want to be a victim anymore and wanted to take control of her situation, and she saw what Batman kind of was able to accomplish wearing the bat suit, so she decided, well, you know what, in order for me to accomplish my goals, this would be a good way for me to kind of know. So that's why we based a lot on the comics and kind of molded her into that kind of
version.
Check it out. It comes out on Blu-ray, DVD, February 2nd, and it's on digital. This is number 8, I believe. I've finished 9. I've got one more, which will make it 10. But yeah, I think it's number 8. So it's quite a bit.
Now, Batman Bad Blood, is this based on which book?
It's actually an original story. There are some elements that we chose and picked from other kind of sources. I mean, of course, you'll see, you know, it's the first introduction of Batwoman. So we do take some of her origin that we do show in the film, as well as, you know, the heretics in it. So we took some from the heretic storyline from the Batman comics. So, but it's, for the most part, it's pretty original.
And I gotta say, impressed that you brought back the bat shorts.
Oh, yes.
I never thought, actually, a new 52 movie, even though they're not using that word anymore.
Yeah.
But still nice to see the bat shorts.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, when we knew that Dick was going to put on the bat costume, we knew that it wasn't going to be the more current outfit that Jason Amara was going to be wearing. So we figured, well, why don't we bring back their gray and blue, you know, and bring that back. And so it was great. So there's a scene in the movie where Dick walks by all of the different outfits, and you'll see the disco version of Nightwing that he had in, you know, when we show that, you know, he has a Robin outfit, the disco Nightwing, and then we show the classic Batman, which he's always wanted to do.
Probably, it was, for me, it was really fun to put Dick Grayson in the blue and gray batsuit, because I've always been a fan of that look from the 70s and 80s, and so that Batwing and Heretic have never been animated before, and it was a lot of fun, you know, being able to basically do something for the first time, when a lot of these, DC has so many legacy characters, they've been drawn by all these brilliant artists and writers and in the past, which I'm always humbled and proud to work on that aspect, but it's also always neat when you get to be the first to adapt it for a different medium. So
this is my third time, yeah.
You having fun with the character?
So much fun. This movie especially was probably the most fun I've had, I think, just in regards to the storyline, number one, but, you know, as an actor, from that point of view, I think I'm finally easing into this whole idea of doing voiceover work. This is the first voiceover work I've ever done, so I feel like I could relax into it and have a lot of fun, and then I was given a great script to work with, so, yeah.
When you started playing Nightwing, did you do any research, like read any of the comics or anything?
You know, a little bit, because I wasn't, you know...
Everybody knows Dick Grayson.
Yeah, I mean, I did know Dick Grayson, I wasn't that familiar with Nightwing, but then sometimes... I kind of like to leave all that aside. You know,
understandable.
I kind of have a fresh take on him and, you know, just sort of like do the best I can to tell the story.
Right.
You know? So, well, yes and no.
It's a huge Nightwing fan. You're nailing the character.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I love him. I love playing him. You know, and I don't know what I do. There's aspects of his character that just resonate so strongly with me, and I have a great time.
Now next is, you on Justice League versus Titans? Is that, or you can't really...
I can't say. Did you ask them?
I haven't asked them yet, okay. But I get it, I get it, I understand.
Yeah, they said, don't talk about the rest. I said, okay.
It's a lot of fun. I mean, it's a little bit of pressure, obviously, because it's the first time that they've done her. I think at the time I wasn't really thinking about the pressure aspect of it, so I had heaps of fun with her. She's really feisty and she's got a sense of humor, which is one of my favorite things about her. And it's funny, you know, it's really fun watching her.
A role model to a lot of women.
I mean, at the time, project in honoring existing characters, non-existing characters, and trying to breathe life into something. So hopefully people feel, I mean, I know there's a lot of expectations obviously on something like this, so hopefully people feel that we've all done it justice.
It's a lot different in the comics because he barely speaks, almost has like a baby-like intellect.
Right.
You can't do that in
right. The
animated series.
I mean, I guess you can. It won't go very well.
Right. I mean, how would you kind of describe the personality?
Yeah, it was interesting because, you know, when I heard The Heretic, I was like, man, that's a great name, but I didn't know a whole lot about the character. I had to do my own digging. Once I had that, I kind of had a starting point for where the character was going to be. And then once I saw the lines, one thing that was kind of established by our director, Jay Oliva, was he's a character that leaves more questions than answers in the beginning. You know, you really have to wait till the end of the film. And that was an interesting challenge because most of Batman's villains to me have such personality, you know,
right,
a defining characteristic, their intellect, bombastic, flamboyant, something. And to just stand his ground, wearing a bat cowl, not saying much, bigger, maybe even stronger than Batman, and then just get in and get out, having done his business. That's almost disturbing, you know. You almost want your Batman villain to leave you with more.
Yeah.
Give me something. You were just here. So that was an interesting challenge. Yeah.
So you have fun playing the role?
Yeah, I mean it was a blast. I had a hard time not shouting during all the lines and trying to be as menacing and as intimidating as possible. You know, I took the directors going like, no, he just talks, which is even more unnerving. You know, the really powerful characters never have to yell to get their points across. You know, they barely say anything at all.
Very calm.
Yeah, and he has some of the best lines. You know, for Batman to say, you know, do I know you? And he says intimately, and not at all. That's just you're like. Okay, are we going to fight now? Who are you? So yeah, it's really great.
Blood. Thanks for staying out in the cold. Thanks for braving the length of time we had to do interviews and get everybody in here. We're going to show you the film, then we're going to do some question and answer with some of the members of the cast. We've got Yvonne Strahovski as Batwoman. Nightwing. Travis Willingham as Heretic. We've got our character designer, Phil Barassa. And our director, Jay Oliva. Lucas Siegel will be sitting in this chair. He's going to moderate tonight. I want you to take good care of him. If you ask the right questions, you'll go home with one of these babies. Autographed by everybody I just mentioned. Yeah, it's a good deal. All right, so we're gonna roll film. You guys have a good time. Ask the right questions. Be good. Applaud at all the right parts. Laugh at the funny stuff. Have a good time.
These things up on the big screen, isn't it? All right, let's bring down your panelists. First off, the voice of Batwoman, Yvonne Strahovski. We have the voice of Nightwing and sometimes Batman, Sean Marr. We have the voice of the Heretic, Travis Willingham. We have the director of Batman Bad Blood, Jay Oliva. And we have the man behind bringing these characters to life in animation, the character designer, Phil Barassa. Lets him stand alone and be the focus of a feature every other time.
He's Batman. He's kind of always been able to straddle both worlds. You know, a lot of the I think most of the core, like, Justice League characters can handle their own, you know, they can be the star of their own film. It's just Batman's popularity has always been, you know, something that, you know, was undeniable. So he's a character that, and he has this rich world. Here is not just Batman himself, but the supporting characters surrounding him are all, you know, almost capable of carrying a film by themselves. So he has this rich history that's always lent itself to its own world.
Awesome. For the actors, when you're playing characters that have this long past, this established history, how do you go about developing those characters versus when you're originating?
I mean, it really depends on the character. Like you said, there's a lot of these characters are legacy characters. They have a long history. Some of them are 70 years old. Some of them are brand new. In this particular film, we had three characters that had never been animated before. Batwoman, Batwing, and Heretic. So it's always kind of cool when you get to be the first to introduce them into a new medium. But they're all different. Like Batwoman, her look in the comics, she's a relatively new character, and her look in the comics is very striking, elegant, and it's already streamlined. So it's almost like you can do a one-to-one and bring it into animation as it exists on the page. Heretic, on the other hand, was sometimes the trickier characters are when the relationship between the name and the powers or the origin and the look is kind of nebulous. And in this particular case, there was nothing about the look from the books that worked for the narrative that we were trying to tell. So in those cases,
you didn't want to do the tiny head, the tiny Damien head on the giant body.
Yeah, I mean, the reference material I had, none of it seemed to fit what we were going for exactly.
Right.
So in those cases, it's trickier because you have to kind of start from scratch, and that can be challenging because we always want to be faithful to the traditions in the comics, as faithful as we can be, while still trying to adapt it for a new medium. So there was a lot more tinkering, a lot more back and forth. There's a lot more rough concept art for him than for a character like Batman.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So, Travis, what would Tiny Head Heretic have sounded like?
I probably would have sounded like this. You're going to destroy your mother. Why don't you love me?
Just picking.
Sean, you're the one out of the actors here that's old hat at this now. This is your third one, and they just announced a fourth one for you with Teen Titans. What are you still learning about Nightwing as you go from film to film with him?
Oh, wow. That's a good question. I'm just still learning everything. Truly, I mean, Nightwing is new to me. When I was approached to do this, I had no idea. I actually thought I was going to be fired the first movie I did, and the second movie I did. And this was actually the first movie that it was like, oh, I might be good at this. So I had a sense of ease and playfulness with this one that I didn't really have the others. But I mean, I'm not privy to the comic book world, I think, as most. So I'm learning as much with each script that comes. I think it's a fresh take on it each time. Yeah. I try and have a fresh spontaneous take on it.
And you got to do your best Batman impression.
Yeah, which I don't know. Were you there that day?
Yeah.
I was trying to make fun of Jason doing the when I had to do Batman. So we got to the first line where I had to do a Batman voice, and I thought I'm gonna make everybody laugh. I'm gonna do the worst imitation ever, and everyone's gonna laugh. It's gonna be so fun. And I did it, and they're like, "We love it." And I was like, "What?" So that's the voice you heard.
Yvonne, you on the other hand are new to this world and new even really to this kind of animated feature. What's your experience of voicing a superhero for the first time?
Yeah, it's a lot of pressure, I will say. I mean, when they first called and said, would you voice
Batwoman, I was rather honored, actually, because it is obviously the first time that she has been animated, so of course I jumped at the opportunity to do it. But I mean, I didn't feel as much pressure then as I do now in the room today, because there's obviously a lot of expectations. It's an iconic character. She's been around for a long time. So, but in the room, it was a lot of fun. You know, I felt supported by the team. You know, showing me the art and everything, and how it was going to pan out. And yeah.
You think you can pull off those moves in real life yourself?
I don't know, maybe.
So speaking of those moves, Jay, I think everyone in this room will agree that this movie has some of the best fight choreography yet. Especially having to bounce back and forth between characters just looks immensely complicated. I know fight choreography is your baby, so how did you go about planning out some of these amazing fight scenes?
It all starts with the script, and so I see, when I read the script, I think about the different action sequences and kind of the different movies that I like to reference or things that I want to see, you know. I mean, when I did Man of Steel, I wanted to like basically do Dragon Ball Z. When I did this, I had just seen Winter Soldier and I thought it was fantastic. So I went to James Tucker and I'm like, hey, can we do the Raid Redemption and can we do that in Winter Soldier and just kind of like amp it up? And you know, because Yvonne was going to be Batwoman, I wanted to really make sure that there was a girl fight in there, which is Yvonne versus Morena, who's
Talia,
sorry. I'm so many movies ahead.
Jay.
Our
animators loved it.
He's like six movies
ahead. Yeah, I'm so many movies ahead. But
his head is in 2018.
So I'm always trying to like top myself and you know, whenever I have like female protagonists who are strong and aren't playing the damsel in distress, I always want to make them like kick ass. And having Yvonne, like after we did the record, I told her, you're gonna get beat up a lot, but you're gonna be really cool, and I'm gonna do my best to make sure that you know the character comes is true to the character, because you know I read the comics, and I really dug her kind of vibe. So when we went and did the fight choreography, I wanted to do a lot of things in it where you know each one, because originally this film was gonna be called Bat Family, you know, and then we changed it to Batwood. But the idea was that I wanted to have the whole Bat Family kind of come together in order to save Bruce, because you know usually. In Justice League film, Batman basically saves everybody. So I liked in this one, you have a vulnerable Batman who's missing for most of the movie, and you know Dick has to come in and kind of fill those shoes, and all of these kind of you know emotions come from that. But then you introduce like you know Batwoman and Batwing and all the supporting characters, and I like the ensemble cast because then you know after a while you just have Batman fighting. By having the different kind of fight choreographies with, you know, Batwoman and her background, having Damian and Dick kind of fighting similar because they were both trained by Bruce, and then having Batwing, who has his also military background, it's nice to kind of get that kind of texture with the fight choreography and coming up with, you know, if you notice with the Batwoman Talia fight, there was sword and gun play, like she's just shooting each other like point blank and swinging swords, and I hadn't seen that before, so that was something that like I really wanted to try to you know push in the film, and also Nightwing fighting Batman. I wanted to do like where Batman's not holding back; he's basically emotionless. He's just gonna be scary, and I liked the one thing I really wanted to do with the fight was the fact that Nightwing defeats Batman by appealing to his emotions. By that's the one thing is Bruce's love for Dick and how he feels about his family and his support group. That's why I wanted Alfred there too. Is what naturally knocks him out from being brainwashed. And I thought that was to me was the strongest thing for the movie.
Awesome. It turned out great. Travis, people listening to you up here as Heretic might not realize that you're usually a heroic voice. You have voiced Superman in the Lego games and movies. What's Superman sound like again?
He's rather heroic.
And you voiced Thor for the other guys as well.
Yes. Or Asgard. A little more British that time, though.
So, what do you have to do to really change your approach to come at something in a villainous form? And also a character that, like you said, really was a little bit more of a blank slate rather than you know, these characters with 75 years of...
I think the energy of the character is what's so important. You know, in the Lego games and movies, they're so much fun to play because it's tongue-in-cheek, there's so much energy, there's a playfulness there, you really can't do anything wrong. You know, it's just a lot of fun, and in these, if that's at one side of the spectrum, this is at the complete other side. It would almost behoove you to come into a session very as calm and zen as you can, because there were a lot of times where you just have to remember to almost do nothing. Just be as still and as menacing as you can without doing too much. I learn a lot from being in the room with Steve Bloom, who's just a legend in the business. When he talks, your shirt moves. You know, it's like being in a rock concert. It's crazy voice. So there's a lot of times where you just have to be, you just have to do a little bit less and try not to give away too much. I liked, Jay at one point was like, we want the Heretic to have more questions than answers. And I really liked that, especially when he says something about, you know, do I know you intimately and yet not at all? Like, okay, well then I guess let's fight, you know. It was a great challenge for me, especially with a lot of characters that are so hands on the hips and chest is out and there's a lot of vibrato when they speak, and just to come down there and be menacing. That's part of that.
Phil, you talked a bit about Batwoman's design, but she was not the only female Bat character. At the very end there, we got a little surprise with Batgirl. She was in the very modern, very new Batgirl Burnside costume.
Yeah.
Why did you decide to bring her in that particular look?
I think it had just come out in the comics at the time, and... You know, I'm kind of old school, so I wanted to do the classic look on her, you know. But it made more sense for the story, because that looks like, basically, she's just starting to emulate Batman at this point. Like, this is her debut. So the cool thing about that costume, one of the cool things is that it looks like something you could actually make. You know what I mean? It looks very practical. It doesn't look too superhero-y, if that makes sense. You know, somebody could totally cosplay that, like, simply, you know, just like a leather jacket and boots and stuff like that, so.
Just a leather jacket and boots.
Well, but basically it looks like something that somebody could practically put together, so it totally made sense, and it looked cool, you know? And so we, initially, James, and I, when we talked about it, we thought we were going to go with a more classic look, but because that had just come out of the comics and it made sense for our story, we put it in.
Plus, like, because this was originally called the Bat Family, and, you know, James and I were talking, like, we should really put Barbara in the end, which is why, again, I made sure that, just like with Batman versus Robin in my previous film, I had Alfred in, you know, doing his thing, because I thought Alfred should be doing something because he's cool. And so whenever you see my films, you'll see Alfred always tries to kick ass, and he does kick ass. And so when we thought about putting Batgirl in it, we were, again, discussing costumes and stuff. But just like Phil said, the idea is that, you know, Batgirl, this is her emergence. She's inspired by what she saw with both Batwoman and Batman and the Bat Family, and now she comes in. So this is actually the basis so that if she does appear in future films, we can build off of her.
Right.
This is her 1.0 costume. Just like Batwing, his costume is the 1.0 of the Batman Beyond costume, which will eventually come. And did you guys pick up that the airship that rises up is the Watchtower? Yeah. So now the backstory to that. So there's a lot of 1.0s in this thing where we're kind of building. You know, we're world building, and the idea is that I wanted to kind of set it up with Justice League War, where, you know, you had Darkseid attack and everybody, all the countries in the world were being attacked by parademons. And so Bruce, you know, thought, well, this would be a great way to build these watchtowers and have a first response. So that way you could have firefighters and first responders from these kind of watchtower things over all of the major cities in order to, you know, in case Darkseid does come back, for example. And so this, when he pitches it to the nations here, was his kind of like, check this out. And of course, they don't go for it because they're like, look what happened, you know, they got taken over. And so I think in the future, we can eventually show that Bruce, in conjunction with Star Labs and Cyborg, will eventually make the watchtower that we'll see that's in orbit.
All that from a question about Batgirl's costume.
Yeah.
It's all
so Batgirl and Birdseye.
Right.
Both Yvonne and Travis have done video game work. Yvonne with Mass Effect, I don't know if you know her. With a game like that, you're doing, you know, all these branching conversations where you're basically answering the same question 20 different ways over and over and over again. So what's the slightly more streamlined approach of doing an animated movie like in comparison?
I guess a little less complicated, but also I feel like I saw more with this. I saw sequences, I think, did I in raw form?
Yeah.
Whereas with the Mass Effect stuff, I don't think I saw much of anything at all except for what the character looked like. So it was even more, I mean, if it isn't already a solo process when you're in the sound booth, like we don't interact with each other at all. It's, you're on your own recording all your own lines. So something like this is a little easier because you're at least having streamlined conversations that, you know, it all follows one storyline versus something like Mass Effect where you're doing all these different avenues of where the game would go.
And are you then getting to see, you said some of the like animatics and stuff like that, so you get to see kind of what's going on in between and not just strictly your lines, or?
No, you don't get to really see, I mean, unless you want to, but you don't really see anything at all. You just see, at worst, you just see a picture of the character and that's it, and you're reading the lines, so, which is why it's great to have an amazing director who really can guide you and understands the world, which is, I mean, like Sean, I'm not really, I didn't grow up reading comics and I wasn't really immersed in them, so I'm learning as I go, because since I've been in the States, I've been thrown into the sci-fi world, and so it's kind of been a step-by-step process, so it really helps to be in a room where you've got a fun team, you know the world and can really show you a lot of art and a lot of clips to help you create a voice.
Very cool. Jay, this was a pretty violent flick, and I hear that when you first sent it out for ratings, it was approaching that R level. What did you have to dial back? What did we miss something from the way you had to change?
There's a few things. I mean, I wish I could scream the R-rated version, but I mean, it's still good. I mean, it's just a few things here and there that just shuffled around. But I didn't think it was R-rated. I think it was about as much as I've done in the past, you know, with Assault on Arkham and Batman versus Robin. So I thought it was okay, but I think, you know,
I think we crossed the line way more in Flashpoint.
Yeah, I think Flashpoint was one of the most.
If there is a line.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, look at the Marvel films and all that stuff.
Yeah. And that's PG-13.
That's PG-13. So I think it's about it. But anyway, that's
a conspiracy.
I wanted to interject this one. I wanted to say this when Yvonne was talking, because when the actors first record, we don't do ensemble cast because their schedules are busy. So they record by themselves, and it's very scary for an actor, especially if they've never done it before. And what we, like she said, like they just have the picture and the script, and we try to, you know, guide them as much as we can. But then they come in right after the animation comes back, and they start to see what we call the A-frame. They do ADR, and that's when they do the oofs and uggs and all that kind of stuff. And I have to say that Yvonne is a natural. She's really good, because the thing is, they have to do it in real time. So what we do is they have to go frame by frame and look at, like, okay, did she get punched there or did she get kicked? Okay, she got hit in the stomach there. And what we do is we have to tell Yvonne, okay, you have two punches to the stomach, a kick to the face, and you get shot, and then go. And then she has to do it right then and there in real time.
Yeah.
And she's really, and also Sean, too, awesome. Like, I had to tell him, your arm gets broken here. So just keep that in mind, you know, when you do that yell. And he keeps all, you do all of the big yells at the end. And I have to give it up for all of my actors, because I beat them up, because all of my films are so super choreographed that in my mind, I'm like, oh, if I was behind the booth, I would do not want to do their job, but they did fantastic. Yeah. I just got to give it up. Thank you.
Heretic didn't really have to grunt a lot in this one.
I think somebody else did it because I kept wanting to do the higher voice thing.
Yeah. All right, we're going to get to fan questions in just a minute, so get your mind set for fan questions. First, I just have to ask you guys, All the way down the row, if you can, if you're a fan, if you know the music, what's the next Taylor Swift song that should get a Batman movie?
Oh God.
Bad Blood?
Anyone?
Yeah, I didn't even know. I hadn't even heard about that song until I started getting questions about it. I don't care. How about that?
I know how much you guys loved that question at New York Comic Con.
Yes. I think they were singing it at Comic Con. New York Con, like, they started singing.
Oh, were they?
I think so.
We also saw Aquaman and Spider-Man doing
it. Yeah, the kid in play was mad. New York Con's the best.
Amazing.
What's that new one? Out of the Woods? Is there another one called Out of the Woods? Why do I know that?
A good point. It would be a good point tonight.
Now we know. Yeah. Justice League, Out of the Woods.
You heard it. Poison Ivy and Floronic.
It's a musical.
Yeah.
It's a musical.
Yeah. Throw on some Taylor Swift songs, maybe we can do something.
Yeah.
All right, guys, if you have some questions of your own, I believe we have a mic we're going to be passing around. And ask good questions. Don't spend a lot of time telling us how much you love the movie. We got that from the thunderous applause. That was awesome. And please don't make, like, weird personal requests.
Half the hands go down.
And if you do, in fact, ask a question that we decide is very good.
Get one of these.
Signed by all of them.
And say your name too, so that way we
yes, and please say
don't be like dude with a plaid shirt or something like that.
But you know what? Let's start with dude with a plaid shirt. just gonna bring down a microphone here for you.
So dude with a plaid shirt here. No, my name is Benjamin. So first of all, one word, nunges. Thank you for that.
Yes.
But second of all, so I have this written out. So animated movies, hands down, have been far better than most of the live-action Batman stuff that I've seen. Are we going to start seeing some crossover from you brilliant people already in animation into the DC live-action-verse? Because from what I'm seeing, I mean, I know that Jay, you've done storyboarding movies and stuff, and it's just natural, and this shit, now the DC universe is coming on.
Okay, so here's the nice thing about Warner Brothers, what they do there, is that they kind of leave us alone in the sense that all of the different departments kind of do their own thing. So, like, you know, Flash, the TV show, doesn't give us notes saying, like, right, hey, we can't have Flash do this. And, you know, Zach doesn't come down and say, hey, we're using this character, so these characters can't appear in your films. So it's really nice that way, and I like that freedom, because if I was working for editor, they would be like, well, we need synergy. So these, you know, our animated shows, our animated films,
they're not in the same continuity.
Yeah, you know.
But there is crossover because, like, we're, you know, producing, directing, and designing Vixen, for instance. The Vixen shorts ties in directly to the CW. We do work with other departments. There is a little bit of that exchange. And it's possible we'll see more of it.
We need your advice. That's all I'm saying.
Nobody's ever going to come to us for advice.
Right. I mean, even when I'm on those films, like when I just finished Batman v Superman and Wonder Woman stuff, like, I'll still be like, I'm just a cogging machine. I'm not the director. So, you know, if they say, hey, we want this, I'm like, okay. I mean, I'm just doing my job, and I try to do the best that I can, because I will say, like, hey, we did this in the animated version. Let me do something different, you know? That's why, like, I worked a little bit on the Flash TV show, too, so I did a lot of things that I wanted to do that we didn't do on Flash,
right,
that I thought, oh, this would be cool, you know?
But the different departments always want autonomy.
Yeah.
The same way we don't want notes from them, they don't want notes from us. Yeah. But yeah, there could be exchanges.
It's fun.
Yeah. Batman sweatshirts.
Everyone's wearing Batman sweatshirts.
Yeah.
Thank you. My name is Q. DC Comics has done a great job, I think, in presenting diversity in their properties over the years. This movie is no exception. African-American hero, gay woman. I really appreciate what you did with Yvonne's character. I was hoping that the guy that played Nightwing, Batwing, was here too. I just want to ask, what goes into your thought processes when you decide what or not to do or show that would underscore the fact that the character is gay or whatever background? So if Yvonne or the director and or the director could answer that.
I remember early on in the draft of Bad Blood, there was a little bit more sensationalizing of the fact that she was a lesbian, and I brought that, and this is really, really somatic. Nothing has, not enough to write at all, but so early on I mentioned to James, I'm like, he agreed with me totally, was that I didn't want her sexual preference to be the reason why she's a hero. I wanted it to just be like, her favorite color is blue. It's just that. I mean, I didn't want to sensationalize it at all, but I didn't want to put it under the rug because I wanted, that's who her character is. And I like the fact that, you know, there we do have a leading character of color, and we have someone who is a lesbian that people can watch and kids can watch, and people can kind of say like, hey, you know what? This is just another aspect of our world, and not to, like I say, sensationalize it. I like the fact that what makes them a hero is by their actions and what they do and how they, you know, help people and how they treat other people and how even through adversity and everything going against them, they still strive to be better and to help as many people as they can.
Wes has been really jacket right up front here.
Hi there. Thanks all for coming. Sean, definitely looking forward to Justice League vs. Titans. Hope that's good.
What's your name?
Michael, sorry.
Hi, Michael.
This question's for Jay and Phil. Now, you guys said in the past that you try to stay away from the comics to weave your own continuity. So my question is, what do you take from the comic versus what you try to make your own? That's my question.
Well, for this one, because prior to this movie, I didn't really know much about Batwoman. I was actually on set for Batman v Superman, and I knew I was going to do this movie, so I called up James Tucker, and I said, James, I have no idea what Batwoman's background is. And he's like, read these comics. And I swear to you, I read like the first 30 issues in like a few days, and I just fell in love with her. And so when we did this story, I thought, well, we need to take some of it, like in terms of like her, how she first met Batman. I wanted to make sure the bar was the same as the comic. But of course there's some things a little different, yeah. You know, and so we pick and choose, and, because it is a different concept.
And it's a different medium, so it's like, you know, again, like Jay said, we have our own continuity. And, you know, a lot of fans have asked, for instance, like, where's Tim Drake? Like, how can Damian be Robin before Tim Drake? But, you know, if you look, we're the film medium. You know, if you look at let's use the Avengers film as an example, right? People don't go, hey, this is not this exact arc from the comics. And we can't do that. We're not basing it on one specific arc. We're creating, like, we're making more of like an impression of like, you know, our version of the DC universe, what works with stories that we want to tell. So it's not pulling directly from any one source, but being informed by all of the traditions and yet going forward and creating our own narrative, if that makes sense.
So see, Yvonne, Jay didn't know much about that.
Yeah, me neither.
Let's go with the glasses and the hat right here. Here, she's going to bring down a mic for you.
Thank you so much.
I'm making our mic runner for you.
My name is Akia Cabrera, and I was wondering how you guys came up with the plot for the movie.
So James Tucker and the writer, James is the producer, they are the ones who really kind of pitched the story. I am more like a line cook. I just get the order. I don't know what I'm going to work on from project to project. It's just whoever gets the rotation. Like, for example, Sam Liu has Justice League Titans. I was working on this when that came about, so I couldn't work on it. So a lot of times it's just the luck of the draw. James is the one who kind of, him, of course, like Bruce Tim too, they are the ones who, I think they pitch it at the meetings, like, hey, what about
right.
this?
Yeah, we have like, I think it's monthly or bi-monthly meetings with DC where, you know, they talk about, you know, what's in the comics, what do we want to do, like what characters that we really want to highlight and stuff like that. And, you know, Jay and I are just like, whatever they throw at us, we kind of have to be ready for anything. So.
Yeah.
Sean, you said that you have kind of thought from movie to movie, oh, I might get fired, I might get fired. Did you know you were signing up for like four of these when you first signed on as Nightwing?
No.
So they just kind of kept calling you back? And you
said, they kept coming. Best Dick Grayson since Burt Ward.
High praise for the show that just celebrated its anniversary.
That's right.
Let's see, I've got this girl right here with the red boner hair.
Oh, God.
She's very excited about it.
I am. I might cry, so just ignore the tears.
What's your name, Mom?
My name is Sydney. So I have a question for the voice actors. I have a feeling that, like, when you're, you know, looking through the script and you're, like, looking at the character and learning about them, like, probably get like an emotional attachment to the characters. Do you get any like creative say in like what your character might, you know, do in a scene, or like, you know, if you feel like one of the lines you're like, oh well, that doesn't sound like something I would say, or do you not like get a lot of leeway when it comes to something like that?
We had to play a lot in the room. Like, there's we're not going to change the script or anything because it's not really ours to change, but there's definitely versions of lines and stuff that, at least with my experience, or different ways to deliver it, you know, you can play around with that, or do alternatives, or you know, so it's quite freeing in that aspect.
Do you interact with each other? Like, do you like
We record individually, separately.
But I mean, like, outside of the room, like, outside of recording and stuff, like, do you not see the script before you go in?
We do see the script individually, but we've only just met.
We just met.
That reaction is priceless right
there. Movie magic!
We're best friends in real life. We hang out all the time. Is that right, Sean?
Yeah. Thank you very much. Jonah. Mike's coming to you here, buddy.
Great movie. Fans of all of you from past stuff and this. Really good. Anyway, what I was wondering was, all the characters have such rich comic book history, and you introduced three big characters in this one. Are there any comic storylines that you perhaps want to see, that you want to see the character go into, going on in this continuity?
I always wanted to have Yvonne continue as Batwoman and do the Batwoman Wonder Woman that was in her Batwoman series. I thought that was a really good kind of storyline, kind of go with what our continuity is. James and I had talked at length because after I remember James was like, I hope Yvonne is good. I was like, no, trust me, she's really good. And after he met her and saw her the first couple lines, he's like, we gotta write more movies with her in it. So, I mean, I'm hoping that we can do that as well as, you know, continue the Titans line, because I mean, Titans is one of the things that we really, really want to kind of push forward and do the Titans, as well as eventually do a Justice League Titans and Bat Family all in one, right? Kind of, you know, that would be a great one to do.
Yeah, it's fun to get back to the Teen Titans characters, because doing the teenage or like younger kid superheroes is always so much fun. You know, when we're working on Batman or when we're working on Justice League, you know, you're working on these like legendary icons that are like godlike. You know what I mean? They have flaws, but they're almost like chiseled in marble practically. The kids, there's a lot more opportunities for levity, lightheartedness. You can see characters growing, you know, as they're going through this stuff. So
it's kind of like Young Justice.
Yeah, exactly. Getting back to Young Justice, so it feels really good to work on that stuff.
Yvonne, you up for some more Batwoman?
Yeah.
Excellent. All right, guys, I think we got time for about one or two more questions here. So this guy has had his arm up for basically this entire time here, and then we're gonna go to guy in a cape.
Hi, my name is Lewis, and I was just wondering if you guys would ever think about if you wanted to, after watching this movie, or maybe even during the process of recording for it, if you ever said, oh, maybe this is something cool that I might want to add, like, you, even though you never said it to, like, the directors or anybody, and you just said, oh, maybe this was a cool idea, maybe we could twist or change, whether it be good or bad. And after seeing Dick Grayson go through some of the old costumes in the Batcave, and we've seen him in one of his older costumes, I thought when you guys were saying something about a musical, I thought that maybe that would be, you know, cool if they just started bursting out singing, and I was like, that would be really funny.
You see Lacer in the next week,
like, or something. I know it's probably too late because the DVD's coming very soon, but that would be
fun. Well, I think we all love to do a musical at some point. I mean, I know James Tucker loves musicals.
Yeah,
James, I love it myself.
James did a classic episode of Brave and the Bold Village.
Yeah, I did that Music Maestro one. And I think what we try to do is try to come with the fans want. So if the fans, if they respond well to this, then we will see more Batman
stuff.
You know? All of these movies are all based upon how the previous one sells. So,
yeah.
I mean, it's really up to you guys to support it. Again, like, I'm just a line cook. I just get handed out whatever the assignment is. So
flipping
if
lines.
I get a Booster Gold film, I'll be awesome. It all comes with the fans, with you guys, and what you guys want to support, what you want to see. And of course, Batman's going to be a staple because it's Batman, you know. He's appearing in the films, he's appearing animated, so you always see that in a lot of the Elseworlds or the other ones that you do. You know, you try to do stuff with fans you really like.
Sean, how many times did you just burst into song and recording?
We had to stop
all
it.
The
we're like,
time.
He's like, that reminds
this.
Me.
Screaming for a dance break. Jazz hands and everything.
All right, my man in tape, last question, make it good.
Thank you, thank you.
No pressure.
My name is Matt, I'm from the Audibly Exquisite podcast, remember that. My question is, you mentioned already about Tim Drake. Was there any thoughts to putting him in this movie? Is there any thoughts to putting him in future movies? Because the movie itself, I love. But they kept talking about family, and you guys have been talking about family, the Bat family, and it's just like, I can't help but ask, where's Tim Drake in that scenario?
He could totally show up, you know? We just haven't gotten to him yet.
But he could show up not as Robin yet, because he hasn't donned the suit. It'd be like us introducing Jason Todd, because Jason hasn't really done this. So again, we are still starting from Batman year, what, 5 or whatever, and working our way forward with the continuity.
For the story we wanted to tell, it made sense for Dick Grayson to be the first Robin, because you got it has to be Dick. And then, you know, if you look at Son of Batman, it totally made sense for the next one up to be Damian. So, you know, it's a remix. If people are too, you know, beholden to one or, you know, stuck on one particular version of the DC continuity, we're not going to be able to please everyone. But, you know, if you stick around, go along for the ride, you might see your favorite character show up. So.
Thank you.
Right on. Thank
you. All right. Thank you guys so much. I'm Lucas Siegel, and let me get, please, Benjamin, Jonah, Q, Michael, and Sydney up here. Thanks again, guys.